Hello everyone, welcome back to Soton Brain Hub. Today, I would like to do a little presentation on the foramina of the skull base. Now, when I say the word foramina, I mean a group of holes in the skull where structures like arteries, veins, or nerves go through. And the term skull base refers to the region of the skull which is exposed when I take off the covarium of the skull and take a look inside in a superior view. Here. This is one of the many topics students studying head and neck anatomy might get confused with, as I have done so for myself. Hopefully, this presentation will give you an insight into approaching the subject with a logical and systematic manner. So this is a picture I took of my skull model, and the first thing I'm going to do is divide the skull base into thirds. The first of the third, marked with my red pen, is something called the anterior cranial fossa. The middle third, with my blue pen, is called the middle cranial fossa. And the final third is called the posterior cranial fossa, with my green pen. The anterior cranial fossa is made up of the ethmoid bone, the orbital plate of the frontal bone, and the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone, here. The middle cranial fossa is from the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone to this ridgy part of the temporal bone, which is the pituitary part of the temporal bone. The posterior cranial fossa will occupy the area posterior to the pituitary part of the temporal bone. I will now go through each of the cranial fossa and talk about the relevant structures in those regions. And compartmentalizing it in such a way will help you remember things better. So let's look at the anterior cranial fossa. So here's a close-up view of the anterior cranial fossa. The first structure you'll come across with is this protruding structure in the midline. This is called the crista galli, and in Latin apparently this means the headpiece of a chicken. So this is my horrible drawing of a chicken, and here's the headpiece, okay? So that's crista galli. Lateral to the crista galli lies a region with many holes in them. This region is called the cribriform plate, here. And this is where the nerve fibers of the olfactory bulb, which is part of the olfactory nerve, travels through, and the olfactory bulb will sit on top as such. And it will carry the sensation of smell via these nerve rootlets back to the olfactory bulb and into the brain. Now, if you look a bit more posteriorly, you can see another pair of protruding structures, this time extending towards the middle cranial fossa, and these are called the anterior clinoid processes, one on either side. Medial to that, you will see a hole where the optic nerve comes out through, aptly named the optic canal. And this is where the visual information will be carried through, and the nasal hemiretinal fibers will cross over or decussate at this point, while the temporal hemiretinal fibers will continue ipsilaterally. This brings me nicely to the middle cranial fossa. So the middle cranial fossa consists of many foramina, so let's look at one in the midline first, which is here. This indentation lies a very important structure of the brain called the hypothalamus, which is our primary brain region responsible for the secretion of many hormones like ACTH to trigger the stress response, the FSH and LH, which are important for our reproductive system, and many more. And from a medial view, it sort of looks like this, and the hypothalamus will sit right here. This fossa that the hypothalamus sits in is called the stella turcica. And the stella turcica, in Latin, apparently means a Turkish saddle. I don't know why it had to be a Turkish saddle per se, but, you know, such is anatomy. Now, I've previously mentioned that the visual information from the hemiretinal fibers decussate at the point which is directly above the stella turcica. And this means that if the patient has a pituitary adenoma, it will expand superiorly, and it's going to compress the decussating fibers. And this will result in a visual field deficit called bitemporal hemianopia, where you lose the temporal vision on both eyes. Behind the salutershka, just erase this for a second. Behind the salutershka lies this structure, which is the dorsum sale, with two extensions on either side called the posterior clinoid processes. For my next foramen, okay, I will tilt the skull just a little bit so that I can see this large slit-like foramen, which is here. And this is called the superior orbital fissure. A lot of structures go through this, most notably the third cranial nerve, the fourth cranial nerve, the first division of the fifth, and the sixth cranial nerve. This can be also visualized if you look into the orbit from an anterior view. Now, let's just go back to the diagram that we were on before. Now, if I set the first division of the trigeminal leaf through the superorbital fissure here, that means that it makes sense structurally and logically that the other two divisions must follow suit posteriorly. The foramen posterior to the superorbital fissure is called the foramen rotundum, which is here, and this is where the second division of the trigeminal, or the maxillary division, exits through. Behind that, the third division of the trigeminal, the mandibular, will exit through this oval-shaped foramen called the foramen ovale. It makes sense anatomically that it's arranged in such way. Now, posterior to the foramen ovale lies another foramen called the foramen spinosum, which transmits the branch of a maxillary artery, which itself is a branch of the external carotid, called the middle meningeal artery. And you can actually see how the middle meningeal artery comes out through the foramen spinosum and makes these grooves here. And the vessel lies between the skull and the dura, and a rupture would result in an extradural hemorrhage, where if this is a CT scan of the skull, you will see an expanding hematoma that is sort of like a halo of an angel here. Okay. Now, lateral to the dorsum sale, okay, you see a large foramen on each side here. This looks suspiciously large, and a lot of students think a lot of structures must go through this foramen. The foramen lacerum, as this is called, is actually, you know, it doesn't really transmit any structures. Instead, its foramen is blocked by a fibrocartilaginous plate. Now, once again, nothing goes through the foramen lacerum. They love asking this trick question on an exam. Now, if you look posterior to the foramen lacerum, you will see a small foramen with a groove leading to the foramen lacerum here. And this foramen transmits the internal carotid artery, and this will travel through this foramen, go along this groove, and sit on top of the foramen lacerum, and it will move superiorly to siphon around the anterior clinoid processes and give up its branches. And this foramen is called the carotid canal. So the foramen lacerum, okay, although nothing goes through it, provides a structural base for the internal carotid artery to sit on. Now finally, let's look at the posterior cranial fossa. On the posterior portion of the petrous part of the temporal bone, you will see a foramen which leads to the body of the petrous part of the temporal bone, which is here. This foramen is called the internal acoustic meatus. And the internal acoustic meatus will transmit the facial and the vestibular cochlear nerve, which are the 7th and the 8th cranial nerve respectively. Looking posterior to that, you will see a large foramen, one on either side, and this is the jugular foramen, which not only transmit the internal jugular vein, but also transmits the glossopharyngeal, our 9th, the vagus, our 10th, and our spinal accessory, which is our 11th cranial nerve. You can actually see the groove leading into the internal jugular vein, okay, which is here, and this is called the sigmoid sinus. But the venous sinuses, you know, there are so much in the skull, and this is a topic for another time. If you look in the midline, you can see this large hole, and this large hole, okay, is called the foramen magnum, and it's the largest of the foramina. Lateral to those, there lies a foramen specifically transmitting the hypoglossal nerve here, and this is actually called the hypoglossal canal. As you can see, we have compartmentalized the skull, and once you have done that, it's not really that difficult. It just requires a lot of pattern recognition and approaching the skull base with a logical mindset. In conclusion, we've talked about the foramen of the skull base from a superior view, and subconsciously we have learned the organization of this cranial nerve and numbering them anterior posteriorly. We know that the first cranial nerve, let's just pick a different color pen. The first cranial nerve goes through the cribriform plate here, and the second cranial nerve, which is our optic nerve, will go through the optic canal here. The third, the fourth, and the first division of the fifth and the sixth cranial nerve will go through the superior orbital fissure, which is not visible here from this view. The second division of the fifth goes through the foramen rotundum. The third division of the fifth goes through the foramen ovale. And the seventh and the eighth cranial nerve goes through the internoacoustic meatus. And the ninth, the tenth, and the 11th cranial nerve will go through the jugular foramen, which are these big foramina on each side. And finally, the hypoglossal nerve will go through the hypoglossal canal here. As you can see, the numbering of the cranial nerves go from anterior posteriorly, and hopefully this lecture helped you remember the organization a bit better. Thank you for watching, and see you soon. Please like, comment, and subscribe to Soton Brain Hub and our new sister channel, Soton Anatomy Hub. Thank you.
Subscribe to Soton Brain Hub for more videos to help explain the mysteries of the brain.